Hi, this is Matt Baker. Today I'm going to give you a brief overview of African history using one of the four fold-out charts from my Timeline of World History book. We've already done a video on the Asian chart, and in future we'll be doing videos on the Americas and Europe charts as well. As I mentioned last time, I don't actually sell a copy of the book on my website. However, you can find it on Amazon and in most bookstores. I'll leave some links in the description and the pinned comment for you to check out. Okay, so let's open the book and turn to the Africa and Middle East section. The chart then opens up like this. Let's zoom in and have a look. So the Africa part of this chart is divided into five sections. Egypt gets its own section, and then the rest of Africa is divided into north, east, south, and west. This allows us to take a look at what was happening in different parts of the continent at the same time. There are also sections on this chart covering the Middle East. We have Syria-Palestine, Anatolia, Mesopotamia, and Iran. But since I already cover a lot of Middle Eastern history on this channel, I'm mostly going to concentrate in this video on Africa. As I mentioned in my Asia video, all of these fold-out charts start at 800 BCE. If you want to see what happened before this, you have to refer to the main chart. Prior to 800 BCE, the only parts of Africa that had urban civilizations were East Africa, North Africa, and of course Egypt. In East Africa, there was the Kerma culture, centered on what is today Sudan. Although far less known than ancient Egypt, Kerma was also a large centralized state, with cities that were flourishing over 4,000 years ago. It served as the main trading hub between Egypt and Central Africa, and produced material goods that were highly advanced for the time. But by 800 BCE, the Kerma culture had faded away, and had been replaced by the Kushite kingdom. Egypt was also in decline. Most of the events that we associate with ancient Egypt, such as the construction of the Great Pyramids and the conquests of pharaohs such as Ramses the Great, all took place prior to the start of this chart. In fact, the first major event on this chart is the conquest of Egypt by the Kushite Empire. This event occurred around the year 750 BCE and resulted in the 25th dynasty of Egypt, the so-called Black Pharaohs from Kush. But around the same time, the Neo-Assyrian Empire was on the rise, and eventually it drove out the Kushites and took over Egypt for itself. Although shortly thereafter, the local pharaoh Psamtik I was able to gain back independence. But Kush continued to be a dominant power south of Egypt. It flourished until the rise of the Roman Empire, and was known for building its own pyramids, much steeper than the ones found in Egypt. Meanwhile, local Egyptian power continued to decline, and eventually it fell to the Achaemenid Persian Empire, followed by Alexander the Great's empire, after which a native Egyptian dynasty never again rose to power. It's important to remember that the final ancient Egyptian dynasty, the Ptolemaic dynasty, wasn't really Egyptian. It was Greek, its most famous member, of course, being Cleopatra. Let's now talk about North Africa. Just prior to 800 BCE, the Phoenicians, who lived in what is today Lebanon, began to colonize the Mediterranean Sea, building cities along the north coast of Africa, the most important of which was Carthage. During the 500s BCE, a Carthaginian known as Hanno the Navigator explored the west coast of Africa, providing the earliest known description of this part of the world. There is some debate about how far he actually traveled. Some deduce that he barely got past Morocco, whereas others conclude that he made it all the way to Cameroon. In the centuries that followed these explorations, Carthage became a major power and famously ended up fighting with Rome over who would reign supreme in the Mediterranean. Of course, Rome eventually won that conflict, and in the year 146 BCE, Carthage was completely destroyed. In the years that followed, we get the earliest Berber states in North Africa, like Numidia, which eventually became part of the Roman Empire. All right, let's now move over to West and South Africa to see what was happening there in ancient times. In what is today Nigeria, there was a civilization known as the Nok culture. They independently discovered how to smelt iron around the same time as Europe and the Middle East. And they also made these really amazing sculptures out of terracotta. But the most important thing that happened in this part of Africa during these centuries was the Bantu migration, also known as the Bantu expansion. The Bantu people originally lived just east of what is today Nigeria, but over a period of 1,000 years, lasting from approximately 1000 BCE to the start of the Common Era, they slowly expanded into Central Africa and then South Africa, to the point where they are now, by far, the dominant group in these areas. Prior to the arrival of the Bantu, the southern part of the African continent was inhabited entirely by the Khoisan people. From DNA studies, we know that the Khoisan are, genetically speaking, the closest people to what the original ancestors of all humans would have looked like. The Khoisan belong to the mitochondrial haplogroup L0, whereas the Bantu belong to L2. L3 represents those who left Africa around 70,000 years ago and who went on to populate the rest of the world. During the centuries when the Roman Empire was dominating North Africa, there were several other important changes that occurred on the continent, which I'd now like to point out. During much of antiquity, the Sahara Desert was not as large as it is today. But as it slowly grew, more and more people, such as the descendants of the Nok culture, were pushed south. And of course, the Bantu people continued to push south as well. Over in East Africa, the kingdom of Kush was eventually replaced by the kingdom of Aksum in what is today Ethiopia. As a result, some other groups in East Africa, such as the Kanembu, were pushed further west into what is today Chad, where they eventually ended up controlling key parts of the Trans-Saharan trade network. But before we talk about them, let me tell you a bit more about Aksum. The Persian prophet Mani, who lived in the 3rd century CE, stated that there were 4 major powers in the world during his lifetime: the Roman Empire, the Sassanid Empire, Han China, and Aksum. Most students of history are very familiar with the first three. However, as is the case with much of African history, Aksum is often overlooked. This is unfortunate because Aksum was indeed a major player in the world at the time. Not only did Aksum control a large chunk of African territories south of Egypt, they also controlled parts of the Arabian Peninsula and traded regularly with India. They were also a major center for early Christianity. Christianity took root there around the same time that it took root in Europe, but interestingly, Christianity evolved in Ethiopia in a slightly different way, something that is often forgotten by European Christians. Thanks to Ethiopian Christians, certain early documents were preserved, ones that ended up being lost in the West. So, up until around 500 CE, urbanization in sub-Saharan Africa was limited to East Africa, with Kerma and its descendants Kush and Aksum being the main location for that urbanization. However, starting with what is considered to be the medieval period in Europe, urbanization began in West Africa as well, the first major state there being the Ghana Empire. But before we look at the great empires of West Africa, I first of all need to mention something that happened around the same time. In fact, it's one of the most important events in all of African history: the arrival of Islam. Islam, of course, originated on the western edge of Asia, not Africa. However, Africa was one of the first places that it spread. First, there was the Umayyad Caliphate, and then the Abbasid Caliphate, both of which controlled the entire north coast of Africa. And then, eventually, an Ismaili Shia state broke away and formed its own caliphate, centered on Egypt. This was the Fatimid Caliphate. With Islam controlling so much of the northern part of the African continent, the new religion started to spread to other parts of Africa as well. So eventually, the Ghana Empire in West Africa became Islamic, and so did the Kanem Empire. However, interestingly, one area that never did succumb to Islam is Ethiopia. As I mentioned earlier, Christianity became firmly entrenched there. There was a brief period in the 9th century when a queen named Gudit, who was possibly Jewish, conquered the Aksumites and burned their churches. But soon thereafter, a new dynasty, known as the Zagwes, rose to power and restored the Christian faith. Okay, let's now go back to West Africa, where we get a sequence of three really big empires. The first, as I already mentioned, was Ghana. It was followed by the even bigger Mali Empire, established by the legendary Sundiata Keita. The most famous king from the Mali Empire, though, is Mansa Musa, who is often credited with being the richest man in all of world history. We did a family tree video for him on this channel, so if you're interested to learn more about his story, I'll leave a link to that in the description. Finally, after the Mali Empire came the Songhai Empire, the largest of the three, but also the most short-lived. It was eventually conquered by Morocco to the north. Morocco had actually emerged as an independent power several centuries before this. First, when the Almoravids split from the Fatimid Caliphate, and then under the Almohads. A couple more things to note before we enter modern history. In Ethiopia, the Zagwe dynasty was eventually replaced by the Solomonic dynasty, who claimed to have been the original rulers of Aksum, and who claimed to be able to trace their lineage all the way back to the biblical King Solomon. We've also done a video on this channel about the Solomonic dynasty family tree. So if you're interested in learning more about them and the history of the Ethiopian Empire, you can check out that video, a link to which I'll leave in the description. Around the same time that the Solomonic dynasty took over Ethiopia and that Mansa Musa was ruling in Mali, we get the first major kingdom in South Africa, the Bantu Kingdom of Mapungubwe, which was the precursor to the Kingdom of Zimbabwe. Here, the Shona people developed the first class-based social system in the region and built the first stone walls and buildings in Africa south of the equator, the largest settlement being the one at Great Zimbabwe. Finally, before moving to the modern period, I should mention that in Egypt, the Fatimids were followed by the Ayyubids, then by the Mamluks, and then by the Ottomans. Okay, so the modern period begins with the arrival of Europeans on pretty much all parts of the continent, and unfortunately, this also marks the beginning of the transatlantic slave trade, in which over 12 million Africans were forcibly brought to the Americas and sold as enslaved people. However, I'd like to point out several independent African states that existed prior to European colonization. First of all, in what is today Nigeria, there were several small kingdoms comprised of the Hausa, Yoruba, and Igbo peoples. It's not shown on this chart, but there was even a small empire known as the Empire of Benin, led initially by Iware the Great, around the same time as the Songhai Empire. There was also the Bornu Empire, which was the successor state to the Kanem Empire, as well as the Kingdom of Congo and the Kingdom of Ndongo. It was in Ndongo that a powerful queen known as Nzinga ruled, and it was from all of these areas that the enslaved people who ended up in the Americas were taken, often with the cooperation of local leaders. To the east, there was also the Kingdom of Mutapa, which was eventually eclipsed by the Razwi Empire, both of which can be seen as successor states to the Kingdom of Great Zimbabwe. Among the earliest European settlements were the Portuguese colony of Luanda which is now the capital of Angola, as well as the Dutch Cape Colony, which started near what is today Cape Town, South Africa. But by the 1800s, the major European players switched to being Britain and France. Britain defeated the Dutch and took over the Cape Colony, leading Dutch settlers, known as the Boers, to form their own independent republics to the northeast. Around the same time, a local ruler named Shaka expanded his territory, creating the Zulu Empire. Meanwhile, in North Africa, the French were colonizing what is today Algeria, and the British managed to take Egypt from the Ottomans. But Europe's role on the continent really took off during what's called the Scramble for Africa, a period that lasted from 1881 to 1914. During this time, almost the entirety of Africa was claimed by European powers, mostly France, shown here in blue, and the United Kingdom, shown here in red, but also Portugal, Spain, Belgium, Germany, and Italy. The only parts of the continent that were not colonized during this period were Ethiopia and Liberia. Although, note that Liberia started as an American colony with the purpose of repatriating former enslaved African Americans back to Africa. During this period, the British defeated both the Zulus and the Boer states to form the Union of South Africa, a dominion of the British Empire that existed until after World War II, which is when many African countries gained independence as well, including Nigeria, Congo, Angola, Algeria, and Egypt. Okay, so that was just a very brief overview of the timeline of African history. Obviously, there's a lot more that could be said, but hopefully you can use this as a jumping-off point to choose a period of African history that you'd like to learn more about. I'll leave some links in the description to some videos on African history that we've done on this channel, and also some links to some other YouTube channels that focus exclusively on African history, such as my friend Jabari over on From Nothing. Thanks for watching.